Chesterton's Orthodoxy is certainly one of the greatest books ever written, ever. It's without question one of the best books of the 20th century. It's a masterpiece of rhetoric. It's a sustained argument, relentless. It's like a train. It just goes right over you. There's a problem, though, with reading it, especially if you're reading it for the first time. Every sentence makes you stop and think. And then you lose track of the argument that Chesterton is making. There's these wonderful zingers, these one-liners. It begs to be quoted. You're busy underlining the next great quotation, and you have no idea what the big argument is that he's making. And you've gotten through the book, and you go, that was a fine book, and you're not quite sure what it was about. The second time you read it, another danger arises. When you read it the second time, you're convinced that Chesterton has rewritten the book since the last time you read it. Completely different things stand out. You go, that wasn't here the first time I read it. And that's distracting, too, because you lose track of the main argument that way. You're continually astounded by the newness of the book, a book that you've already read. The third time you read it, it starts to bear fruit. So, if you're going to start with this book of Chesterton's, you really haven't read it till the third time you've read it. The other thing that is troubling when you read it is that unless you put yourself at Chesterton's mercy and let him lead you along, you also lose track of what the argument he's making. Everything he says is surprising and unexpected. He takes you in directions that you just don't expect. You must put yourself at his mercy, and then he will lead you to great places. What we're going to try to do is get through the book and the arguments he's making, and we're going to try our very best not to get waylaid and start quoting the book. With heretics, it was easy to just read one great passage after the other. With Orthodoxy, if we get started, we won't be able to stop. So we're going to discipline ourselves, and we're going to try to get through the book and point out what the main arguments are. And they may even seem a little dry just by sticking to the main arguments. I doubt it, but they may. It's certainly in Chesterton's presentation, they're wonderful, and undoubtedly Chesterton's presentation is better than mine. In the introduction, Chesterton starts off by saying that this is not going to be an ecclesiastical treatise, but rather a slovenly autobiography. He's talking about how he arrived to the Christian faith. But he does it in a very interesting way. He says it's not going to be done by a series of deductions, but rather by a series of mental pictures. And what those pictures showed him, and will hopefully show us, is that there is this need we have for a faith and for a philosophy, just the right mix of the unfamiliar and the familiar. We must have both in our lives. There's one word for that, and that's romance. And he does point out that the main theme of the book is that the only basis for sound ethics and sound energy in a society is Christian theology. Christian theology as summarized, he says, in the Apostles' Creed. That's one of the reasons why the book is so hard to argue with, because of the fact that Chesterton is saying, this is what happened to me, this is what I found. You can't argue with him and say, well, that is not what happened to you, and that's not what you found. It makes the book even stronger because of the approach he takes. It's a piece of literature, truly, and yet it's certainly not nonfiction, and it's not like any other book that you'll ever read. The second chapter, The Maniac, he establishes in both this chapter and the following chapter, The Suicide of Thought, what's wrong with the world? What's wrong with modern philosophy? Every modern philosophy, if taken to its logical conclusion, will lead to madness. Beyond that, it will lead to self-destruction. He says that a typical modern philosophy will say, well, it'll teach you to believe in yourself. Chesterton says all the people who believe in themselves are in insane asylums. You have to believe in something outside yourself in order to be sane. And the most obvious thing to believe in, the most obvious thing out there, is original sin. That's the only Christian doctrine that can be proved. It's evident right out in the street. What the modern philosophies have done is try to deny even original sin. Oh, I was going to make a quotation. I'm not going to. Read it for yourself. Or maybe we could talk about it later. The modern thinkers, he says, are all locked in a clean, well-lit prison of one idea. And even here, he's starting to hint at what the solution is going to be. It's going to lie in paradox. The modern thinkers are stuck on one idea, and that's where they go crazy. That's where modern philosophy goes insane, whether going one direction or the other. Chesterton says truth is going to lie in a paradox of two competing truths that seem to contradict each other but are both true. That's the only place where sanity lies. Chesterton says there's two kinds of madmen, those who cannot believe their senses and those who cannot believe anything else. That summarizes the two forms of modern madness. We are suffering, he says in chapter 3 of The Suicide of Thought, under a broken society. What's happened in a broken world? He says, in a broken society, the vices run wild and they do great damage. But he says the virtues also run wild and do even greater damage because they are isolated from each other and are wandering alone. And thus you'll have some people who care only about truth and some people who care only about pity. But those who care only about truth, their truth is pitiless. And those who care only about pity, their pity is untruthful. There is not a better explanation anywhere of the dichotomy between the conservatives and the liberals than that description right there. Truth that is pitiless and pity that is untruthful. And that illustration points to the truth of the great commandments, the two great commandments. You have to love God with all your heart and love your neighbor as yourself. You must love God and love your neighbor. Your truth has to have pity. Your pity has to be truthful. It all comes together. One of the necessities for sanity is the belief that there is objective truth. The wild lawlessness and the mindless materialism lead to the same void, the same kind of madness, which is using mental activity to achieve mental helplessness. So in those chapters 2 and 3, Chesterton, when he gets through them finally, he says, now we've dispensed with the unpleasant part of the book. Now we can talk about what it is that I believe and what is the good things. But he first has to establish what's wrong. He has to establish the problem and then talk about what the solution is. And in chapter 4, which is called The Ethics of Elfland, he has written one of the greatest of all his chapters. It's a chapter that has profoundly affected the people who've read it throughout the years. This is where he starts to offer evidence for the eternal truths in a creative and original way, really unmatched by any other modern writer. And you can see how he has affected other writers in this chapter. C.S. Lewis, J.R.R. Tolkien were enormously affected by this chapter, The Ethics of Elfland. He starts out in an amazing way. He talks about how common sense is the basis for democracy. The idea of self-government and self-control and self-sufficiency is all based on the idea that most of us should be able to do most of the basic things for ourselves. And we shouldn't have anyone else interfering with those basic activities. It makes perfect sense. You know, you want to be able to blow your own nose. You don't want someone else to do it for you. Also, you want to be able to write your own love letters. No one else should do that for you. We can leave the specialist to do certain things like discover the North Pole and look through a telescope, the basic things we need to do for ourselves. That's the basis of democracy and common sense. What Chesterton does then is he extends this common sense backwards through time. And he says, just like democracy means everybody gets a vote, well, let's also give a vote to our ancestors. They get a vote too. And he calls that tradition. Tradition means giving a vote to our ancestors. There are these truths that are handed down through time. And then he, in a wonderful way, he points out how these truths are handed down. One of the key ways they've been handed generation to generation is through stories. And one of the best kinds of stories are the fairy tales. And Chesterton says he learned these fundamental lessons in fairy tales before he'd ever heard of Christianity. Things like the world is a place of great wonder and great beauty and great mystery and magic and danger. He learned the doctrine of conditional joy, what he calls the doctrine of conditional joy from fairy tales, that you will be happy as long as you keep the rule. The carriage is going to turn into a pumpkin at midnight. You can have fun, but you have to remember, be home by midnight. You can be happy if you don't eat that apple. The other thing he learned from the fairy tales is that life itself is a story, which implies that there's a storyteller. And he, from looking at this magical world, he realized that none of the natural explanations he's heard of this magical world have ever been satisfactory to him. He knows that there's meaning there. He knows there's meaning in the world, but meaning must have someone to mean it. He knows that there's goodness in the world, but he also recognizes that the goodness has somehow been spoiled somewhere, and it needs to be restored, and that it's been rescued, just like Robinson Crusoe rescued the goods from the ship. The next chapter, The Flag of the World, could be alternatively titled Loyalty to Life. It's about the fact that, he starts by saying there's two kinds of people, there's two kinds of approaches to the world. There's the optimist and the pessimist. Both these approaches are wrong. The optimist thinks everything is good, except the pessimist, and the pessimist thinks everything is bad, except himself. What Chesterton recognizes is that you can't go around like the optimist and say that there are no problems. You have to recognize that there is misery in the world. But you can't, like the pessimist, be totally hopeless and totally despairing and give up on the world. When you love something, you love it for reasons, but when it is miserable, you have to love it even more. And that's what a true patriot does. That's what a true lover does. He's even more devoted to the thing he loves when it is miserable. That's a basic truth Chesterton recognizes that was different from the way the modern world was approaching it. And he saw this fundamental truth in patriotism. He said men did not love Rome because she was great. She was great because they loved her. And in that, he starts to get at the fact that religion is the basis of morals. Morals do not come about by just an agreement that we're going to be nice to each other. In other words, Chesterton totally rejects the social contract theory. He says people have gained their morality by guarding their religion. And the more transcendental your patriotism, the more practical are your politics. The more transcendental is your patriotism, the more practical are your politics. In other words, can we hate the world enough to change it and love it enough to think it worth changing? He also recognizes in this chapter that there's this hole in the world and only Christianity can fill it. What that chapter does is it sort of answers the dilemma that was presented in chapter 3 about the suicide of thought, the self-destruction of modern philosophy. Chesterton addresses that in this chapter of The Flag of the World. In the next chapter, The Paradoxes of Christianity, he answers the dilemma that is brought up in chapter 2, the maniac. He gets at the idea that truth has to be this combination of truths, that it has to have at its heart some mystery that we cannot explain. But that mystery, by accepting that mystery, we can explain everything else. What he says in the chapter on the maniac is that the lunatic tries to explain everything and make it clear and ends up makes everything confusing. What the mystic does is allow one thing to be mysterious and then everything else becomes lucid. And he has a great description or explanation of how paradox works. Just as our visual, our physical sight is stereoscopic, we see two different pictures with two different eyes, but we see better because we see with two different eyes. Well, our spiritual sight has to also be stereoscopic. We see two different pictures with our spiritual vision, and we see all the better for that. Thus, we can believe that there is such a thing as fate, but also such a thing as free will. And we can believe that children, he says, are the kingdom of heaven, but they have to obey the kingdom of earth. And that's why we could admire youth because it's young and age because it is not. The normal man is a mystic because he can balance these truths together by accepting that mystical contradiction between them. Well, in this chapter on the paradox of Christianity, he points to what the ultimate paradox is. And of course, it's Jesus Christ, fully God and fully man. We cannot comprehend that. We can't even pretend that we do. We have to accept it. We have to accept that in one being, God fully exists, and so does humanity. There's a human there, and there is a divine creature at the same time. Not a creature apart from man and God, like an elf, and not a creature that's half man and half God, like a centaur, but fully God and fully man, love and wrath both burning. Sanity is an equilibrium, says Chesterton. It's a keeping of the balance. And he noticed that that Christianity was true, not because of any great defenses he'd read of Christianity, but because of how absurd and contradictory were all the attacks on Christianity. They came from all different directions, and Christianity was criticized for absolutely opposite reasons, of being too bright and too gloomy and too worldly and too otherworldly. And that's what started to get him to think that there must be something to it if its enemies don't mind contradicting each other in their hatred of it. He says maybe, he thought, maybe Christianity is sane and the critics are mad. And as I said, sanity is an equilibrium. And that's why, when you're trying to keep your balance, he could look at the history of the church and see how there were sometimes violent arguments about one small point of doctrine. He said, well, that makes all the sense in the world, because an inch is everything if you're balancing. You have to get it exactly right. And he has this wonderful vision of the truth going through history, the wild truth, reeling but erect, always on the verge of losing its balance, but never quite. Chapter 7 is called The Eternal Revolution. And the point here is he's addressing that we have to fix a broken world. And in order to fix a broken world, we have to have a fixed standard, a fixed ideal. Reform implies form. And thus he attacks the theory of progress, because that theory is directly tied to Darwinism. In order to fix a broken world, you have to regain something that was lost. A revolution means a turning back. And we're constantly losing. The truth that we've achieved is constantly in a state of decay. We have to reform. We have to have a revolution to regain it. He says all tradition is a series of revolutions, of trying to regain something that is decaying. The theory of progress is that things are just naturally getting better all the time, getting better. And that, of course, that theory came along because of Darwin. And he says that theory does not promote any sane morality at all. You don't get any moral ideas from that theory. There is, in a sane world, a need for proportion. Proportion implies design. Design implies a designer. Every revolution occurs because of this loss of proportion. He says, true conservatism is an eternal revolution. If you want to have a white post, well, you paint it white, and if you just leave it, it's not going to remain white. You have to keep painting it white in order to have a white post. So true conservatism, true tradition, means constantly repairing, watching, restoring. He sees that this only happened with the Catholic Church. Again, this evidence pointed to the Catholic Church. I guess I need to decide. He wasn't Catholic when he wrote this book. So he's talking about Christianity in general, but it's a very Catholic book. There's only one line in the whole book that indicates he's not Catholic. But that's one of the greatnesses about this book. It's truly an ecumenical work, too. It appeals to non-Catholics and Catholics alike. His next chapter is The Romance of Orthodoxy. And here he talks about the importance of getting the doctrine exactly right. And that when people try to liberalize doctrine, when they try to liberalize theology, they end up not being more liberal, but creating more restriction in the world. If you want liberty, you don't do it by liberalizing theology, you do it by adhering to the proper theology. His point in this chapter is orthodoxy is not only the only safeguardian of morality and order, but it's also the only safeguardian of liberty, of innovation, of advance. And the modern thinkers are always trying to make everything muddy, by doing away with clear doctrine. He says it's your modern theologians who are trying to argue that Buddhism and Christianity are just alike, especially Buddhism. Again, he says if we want reform, we must adhere to orthodoxy. He says the hope for universal salvation, he says, is imperative. We should all hope that, but we should never assume it. To assume it is disastrous. If we want to make things go right, we have to insist that they may go wrong. We don't know how the story is going to end. Evil's a choice. And so any moral reform has to be active and never passive. And he found in Christianity the most manly philosophy of all. He found that any attacks on Christianity did not damage Christianity whatsoever, but they did destroy all the secular things. The secularists have not destroyed Christianity, they have destroyed the secular things, he says, if that's any comfort to him. The ninth chapter, the last chapter of the book, is called Authority and the Adventurer. In this chapter, he says, the moral atmosphere of the incarnation is complete common sense. That's what he found. And he found that all the arguments against the incarnation are common nonsense. He found that the Christian explanation was the most satisfactory explanation of all, and all others were unsatisfactory. What's really interesting is there's one line in this book that indicates, it basically sums up the everlasting man in one sentence in this book. So he's already got the whole plot of the everlasting man working in his mind 20 years before he wrote it. He said, once heaven came upon the earth with a power or zeal called the image of God, whereby man took command of nature. And once again, in empire after empire, men had been found wanting. Heaven came to save mankind in the awful shape of a man. So that's the argument of the everlasting man. First, there's this unique creature called man coming in the image of God, and then there's this unique man called Christ coming as God to save the earth. Something miraculous happened, and the skeptics deny it, and the skeptics deny miracles for all the wrong reasons. And in one sentence he talks about he believes miracles just because there's evidence for them. And he has inspired C.S. Lewis's book on miracles in just one sentence in that chapter. And he's found that the church was like a parent. It didn't merely tell this or that truth. It revealed itself as a truth-telling thing. and that's why he was able to accept it. And he saw, he says, Catholic doctrine and discipline may be walls, but they are the walls of a playground. There's this safety inside the walls, and there's this freedom within the walls. And if you take away the walls, if you take away the doctrine, the discipline, there's no safety. There's great fear, and there isn't freedom, because there's sort of a huddling together because you're not protected by anything. And his argument is that man cannot expect any adventures in the land of anarchy, but a man can expect any number of adventures if he goes traveling in the land of authority. Truth must be declared by some authority. And he says, this is the prime paradox of our religion, something that we've never in any fully sense known. It's not only that truth is something better than ourselves, but even more natural to us than ourselves. That we are not in our normal condition. We are longing for this place we've never been. We know that's home. We are homesick for a place we've never been. He concludes the book with explaining the differences between paganism and Christianity. He says the pagans and the moderns who attempt to be pagans were miserable about everything, but jolly about everything else. The Christians, particularly the Christians of the Middle Ages, were at peace about everything, but were at war about everything else. In other words, melancholy should be an interlude, but praise should be the permanent pulsation of the soul. Joy, the small publicity of the pagan, is the gigantic secret of the Christian. Such a great secret that even according to Chesterton, it was the gigantic secret of Christ himself. The last chapter of Orthodoxy is a marvelous passage, and I urge you to read it, but I urge you to read the entire book leading up to it first so you can realize how marvelous it is. Orthodoxy.